I feel like the head teacher. Class. Well, I want to welcome you to the 25th anniversary of Women Helping Women. We've been doing this for a quarter of a century, and I have to say, the energy and ambiance in this room never gets old. My name is Susan Voss, and I'm the co-chair of this year's event, and I'm honored to celebrate this moment with everyone here today, whether it's your first time attending or it's your 25th. Nobody involved with the first Women Helping Women back in 1999 could have predicted the impact, growth, and huge success that this event has transformed into. It's all due to the dedicated committee members, center staff, generous support from donors, sponsors, and the amazing women who have served as honorees and speakers over the years. We thank you for your continued belief in Women Helping Women and its purpose. Today we look back on the past 25 years and while keeping the next 25 years in mind. Now I'm going to do a little housekeeping here. The restrooms are located just outside. There are six, to your front and your back, to your left. I encourage you to take the envelope that is at each setting home with you today. It includes the center's annual report, a conversation card, courtesy of Shirley Portner, and a postcard from Jan Fried for your personal use. Please use our event hashtag, Women Helping Women 25 Years, to share photos and stories from today's 25th anniversary event on social media. As a reminder, today's program will be recorded, and everyone who contributed to the event will receive a link to the recording. We are really grateful to CLE Productions for helping us facilitate this event and making it accessible to those who aren't with us today. So hopefully you left your mark on the art canvases that are located just outside the ballroom doors in the atrium area. Thank you to Laura Palmer for creating this work that invites us to all participate. The purpose is to represent the community that makes up Mind and Spirit Counseling Center. Each colored dot represents a different group: clients, adults and children, telehealth services, and donors, volunteers, and staff. This is being done to celebrate the 25th years of Women Helping Women and will be displayed at the center. Today marks the 25th time that women and some men have gathered in support of Mind and Spirit Counseling Center and access to mental health services for women, children, and families. We are proud to report that because of you, along with others who couldn't be with us today, we have raised a record-breaking $282,495. We had set a lofty goal of $250,000 in honor of the 25th, so we really exceeded it. And if anybody in the room wants to whip out their checkbook right now and write us a check for $18,000, and I'm sure we would, also take Venmo, we could get to $300,000. Wouldn't that be terrific? The money raised will provide mental health services to those who are underinsured and otherwise wouldn't have access to help they deserve. On behalf of the Planning Committee and the Center, I'd like to offer a heartfelt thank you to each and every one of you, and I mean that sincerely. Something you might notice different from the other years we've hosted this event is the name Des Moines Pastoral Counseling Center is nowhere to be found because we've changed that name to Mind and Spirit Counseling Center. Our new name allows us to stay true to our mission and continue our commitment to a holistic healing process involving body, mind, and spirit. It also elevates our commitment to inclusivity and eliminates the confusion for anyone who assumes we are affiliated with any specific faith tradition. The center's mission, people, and programs remain the same. With today's record-breaking numbers, Women Helping Women has raised over $2 million since its inaugural event in 1999. From meager beginnings to packed ballrooms, each year has made a difference in our mission to bring hope and healing through counseling and education to women, children, and families. The theme for this year's event is Purposeful Connection, Living a Life with Meaning. I'm glad you are here today connecting with us purposefully and recognizing the meaning of the 25th anniversary celebration. It's a reason we keep coming back year after year. So with that being said, it's time to kick things off by inviting one of the few men in the room to share some meaningful words. Please welcome Jim Hayes, the center's executive director.
We are a small but mighty group of men. Should we all grunt? It's good to be with you. Thank you so much for being here today. That number is incredible. You can't believe what good work that is going to do for us and the work that we do at the center. I'm so, so grateful. And I'd like to just thank all of you again by giving yourselves a round of applause. Years ago, when I was just getting started, I went to a workshop, one of those Stephen Covey things, and had to work on my personal mission. And what it turned out to be was that I and those I encounter might flourish. It's a simple statement, but it's really something that gets to the humanity of each one of us, that whomever we encounter in life, we can really make a difference. And so I think about that with the center, that we walk with people through counseling and education to find hope and healing and to lead a fulfilling life. Get that? A full life. We're trying to find ways for ourselves and those we encounter to lead a full life. That's why I'm so grateful to Jan today for the message that she's going to give to us, and Connie for the difference that she's made. We're talking about, through this entire program, what does it mean to lead a life that matters? And for me, there's kind of four foundational pieces of it. One is that we encounter mystery in our lives and wonder. It might be divine, it might be something that is for you a holy figure or something like that. We encounter mystery in our lives, but we do it in the context of community. It's not just about us. We do this as we walk together as a people. And it's not just about us finding lives that matter and kind of the mystery of life. It's about others doing so as well. So service is a necessary component of leading a full life. And finally, for me, it's about joy. We do all of this stuff so that we might be fulfilled and find joy in the way that we live our lives. And I thought, well, let's go ahead and play with this a little bit and see in the life of the center, now that we're 51 years old, what kind of fulfilling life has the center had? If it's about mystery, it's about an encounter with the divine. I can tell you right now, over to my left is Ellery Duke and Eileen Bertle, two of the people that I consider founders of the place. I think we should give them a round of applause for being here. You'll see Eileen was the first speaker and honoree because it was just a few people in a room with a basket for a free will offering, all right? Amazing work what this has become. But my guess is, and I know from talking to Ellery, there was plenty of encounters with the divine and mystery because there was lots of praying going on. Are we gonna be open tomorrow? You know, can we meet payroll next week? It's the nature of nonprofits to live on the margin, to do this good work and not having enough resources to do it. You really do need to encounter mystery and miracle to make it happen. And you do it in the context of community, and that's what this is all about. The center has never been about just a couple of therapists kind of trying to run the place. It's about a community that from its origin was people in Des Moines organizing themselves to create a pastoral counseling center. It's about the community of donors and volunteers. This doesn't just happen in the therapy rooms with our wonderful therapists. It's about this. It doesn't happen if we don't do this together. So that life of service is an easy one for us to figure out. I mean, I was trying to do some math, and I'm a theologian, so give me a little bit of a break on this. But I was doing averages over 51 years, and if you think about it, the thousands of people that we help each year, I'm figuring it's somewhere over 100,000 people in the time that we've been around. Individuals, families, kids. But then if you take it in terms of sessions that we do in a year, it's probably more like 750,000 sessions that have happened in the history of the center. Think about that. 750,000 times, somebody coming seeking hope and healing and finding someone who cared to walk with them. That's an amazing bit of service. And then joy, I mean, that's the hard part for all of us because most of us don't get to sit in that room. Our therapists are here and we'll acknowledge them in a little bit. A lot of our staff are here. They know the miracles that happen in those rooms, the healing that happens in those rooms. And for me as an administrator, this is the way that I kind of do my mindfulness when I'm stressed out about the place. I watch people walking out our doors. And people who went in, maybe crying or their lives broken, find hope, find healing, and just get a little bit of a touch or a glimpse of what the joy of a full life might look like. And it works. People find healing. You can get better. That's the joy that we all share. Now, I have to look. 10 seconds left. I am so good. They have a timer. I'm a preacher. Shut up, Jim. Now's the time. Cut it off right now. Speed it up, Padre. If we're about leading lives that matter, I hope today provides you an opportunity to reflect on your purpose, the meaning of your life, the meaning of the center, and that all of us can go forth to take this cause into the lives of others because it matters. May our time be blessed, may the food be blessed, and the mission we take forth from this room be blessed. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you. I'm Ann Kelly, the other co-chair of this year's event, and I hope you're enjoying a tasty lunch and connecting with those around you. Thank you to the Embassy Suites for being a gracious host to us for the past 10 years and for the generous donation of our desserts today. I'm happy to recognize all of those who have made the 25th anniversary event the best yet. While I do that, will you please hold your applause until we're finished? Thank you to the Planning Committee for their dreams of going big and making those dreams a reality. When a $250,000 goal was proposed at a meeting, no one held their breath longer than Development Director Lori Sloterdijk. However, every member of the committee and staff fully embraced the idea. 25 years, $250,000, why not? The results have been phenomenal. Each committee member contributed their time and talents over the last several months to make today happen, and I know Lori is breathing easier today. Thank you to the Underwriting Committee for their financial support, advocacy of our cause, reaching out to networks, and being a key ingredient to the event's ongoing success. Thank you again. Please recognize the Board of Directors. We are grateful for your thoughtful leadership. For the new members and those serving a second term, thank you for your guidance and vision for the future. The attendance, if in attendance, please wave. Board members, thank you, thank you. A big shout out to the Mind and Spirit Counseling Center staff, current and past. Thank you for walking with their clients on a road to hope and healing, and for serving the mission that we share. To any current or past staff who are here with us today, a sincere thank you. We are so grateful for our sponsors, also listed in your program. We are thankful for your support and the generosity that you extend to us. Our deep appreciation to the following: our presenting sponsors who contributed $10,000, Barbara and Michael Gartner, Susan and Carl Voss. Our leadership sponsors, Patty and Jim County, Kate Garst, the Graham Group, Charlotte Hubble, Rusty Hubble, Hy-Vee, the Isaacson families in honor of Connie Isaacson, Tom and Linda Kane, Polk County supervisors, Karen Schaff and Steve Jane, Tony Urban, Sally Wallace, West Bank. Thank you also to our supporting sponsors who donated $2,500 and whose names are on the screen and in your program, along with the contributing sponsors who donated $1,500. A special thank you to our media sponsor, Business Publications Corporation. We are grateful for your continued assistance in helping us promote Women Helping Women. In addition to our sponsors, we are grateful to special friends, Leader Plus, leaders, and young leaders, as well as friends of the center and in-kind donors for their generous support. As mentioned, this year isn't an ordinary year, it's an extraordinary year. We pay tribute to 25 years of women helping women. Though Susan Mark thanked the past honorees and speakers, I want to acknowledge them and the impact that they've had in our community. From everyone in this room, a sincere thank you for your leadership, and join me in recognizing these influential women. honoree today really doesn't need any introduction. She probably knows about everyone in this room. But I'm delighted to recognize Connie Isaacson. Connie has so many accomplishments that we'd be here all day if we were asked to list them. Connie has more than 30 years of broad-based community leadership at the local, state, and national levels. She earned the distinction of a certified fundraising executive and has assisted in organizations in raising over $120 million. While Connie has great ties to Women Helping Women, it's her dedication to the center as a whole that earns her the title of honoree. In 2008, when the center's capital campaign was floundering because of the country's recession, Connie was brought on as a consultant to work with the board, staff, and campaign committee. Her recommendations undoubtedly saved the campaign, culminating in the wonderful facility that we housed for the past 12 years. As our former executive director, Ellery Duke, said, we wouldn't be here without Connie. This is just one story of many where Connie's expertise and leadership helped save the day. She has a way of uniting people around a project and inspiring action. She is a key connector in our community and has the ability to survey a project's breadth, depth, and impact. As friend Jane Fogg shared, Connie is a consummate professional, friend to many, and a champion of the nonprofit community. Her ability to share her vision and motivate those around her while thinking logically and strategically has inspired so many of her collaborators to want to be like Connie. She has a wonderfully kind, efficient, sincere manner that lets her lead with grace and aplomb. Anyone who has had the opportunity to work with her knows what a privilege it is to have received her wisdom, gracious spirit, and deep kindness. Connie doesn't relish being in the front of the room. She's not nearly as comfortable there as when she sees others in the limelight. This talented woman can do it all, but rarely talks about all that she does. It's just part of her charm. Alongside with her notable career, Connie has also been an attentive and caring wife, mother, grandmother, friend and mentor to the nonprofit community. It is my pleasure to present to you the 2023 honoree, Connie Isaacson.
Thank you for those very kind words, Anne. I'm really excited to be here today. In this room filled with nearly 600 supporters of the Mind and Spirit Counseling Center and to celebrate 25 years of this wonderful event. I'm really excited to see faces of longtime friends. I am excited to see former Women Helping Women committee members and community leaders with whom I've had the privilege to work. I'm also excited to see many new faces. Welcome to those of you who may be attending for the very first time. And a quick shout out to my very special my wonderful husband, Dick, my five remarkable adult kids, their loving spouses, and 11 of my 18 grandchildren are here today. And unbeknownst to them, they are now going to come on stage with me, and we're going to sing, "We're All Together Again, We're Here, We're Here." Oh no, that's what we do at Cousins Camp in July. So take the panic look off your faces, Team Grant. 25 years ago, as a member of the center's board of directors, the board was charged with creating a fundraising event. The center needed money, as Jim said. And 25 years ago, my board colleagues, including DJ Newland, Mary Kramer, Diane Meek, Cheryl Seipel, and Judy Winkleplek, who are all here today, began to plan that first Women Helping Women event. We could never have imagined then that the event would continue after 25 years. That first event was on March 18, 1999. It was attended by fewer than 100 persons. It was in a hospital conference room, and the keynote speaker was Eileen Bertel, one of the esteemed counselors at the center. And Eileen is here today. Thank you, Eileen. The fee to attend was $10, and the day's profits? There were none. The expenses exceeded the income. Fast forward to today and the remarkable growth of the event, from less than 100 persons to 600 persons in the room today, from no profits in 1999 to $282,000 today, every dollar to support the center's mission of providing hope and healing to those in need. Mental health touches every single one of us. My first personal experience is that my older brother died by suicide when he was 20. And I was just 18, a recent high school graduate, and heading off to college to study nursing. I remember the pain his death caused, the guilt it created, and the toll it took on my family. I especially remember my mother's reaction when I told her I thought seeing a counselor might be helpful. She had experienced great trauma, some would say the greatest trauma. Her response to me was, "Connie, I am not crazy, and I do not need counseling." In 1965, in rural Iowa, and in her mind, counseling was perceived to be a sign of weakness. I have always believed reaching out for help through counseling is a sign of strength, and I believe that even more today than I did as a young adult. I also believe that good health means good physical health and good mental health. They are intrinsically intertwined and equally important. 25 years ago, we could not have imagined the impact social media would have on our youth, actually on all of us, nor the increased anxiety, depression, and addictive behaviors that would result from its constant use. 25 years ago, we could not have imagined that a worldwide pandemic would sweep throughout our nation and forever change our lives, resulting in more than 1 million American deaths, extreme isolation, loneliness, and greatly increased mental health needs. 25 years ago, we could not have imagined that death by suicide would become the second leading cause of death in young persons between the ages of 15 and 24. As needs spiral higher and higher, I am tremendously grateful for the Women Helping Women Luncheon, not only as our spring tradition where we come to network, socialize, and be inspired by the keynote speaker, but also an event that provides critical funds and significant impact on the ability of women, children, and families to access counseling services. I feel very humbled to be honored today, and in fact, I believe the word honoree should become plural to honorees. The Women Helping Women event has always been and continues to be a true team effort, a team of volunteers and staff members who work enthusiastically and collaboratively to make the event happen year after year. My math tells me that probably more than 150 women have served on the committee at some point over the past 2.5 decades. And I'd like to share this recognition with all of you who are in the room today. So if you have ever served on the Women Helping Women Committee, would you please stand now? As Anne mentioned, I'm a really passionate advocate for nonprofit organizations, not just the Mind and Spirit Counseling Center, which is very important to me, but many others as well. Being actively connected to the nonprofit sector has provided me meaningful work and lifelong purpose because nonprofits positively impact every aspect of our lives, every one of us in this room. Without volunteers and nonprofits, Central Iowa would not have a nationally recognized skate park along the downtown riverfront. Meals on Wheels would not be tripling its capacity to prepare and deliver 3,000 meals per day in newly renovated, bigger space. Trees Forever would not be planting hundreds, if not thousands, of trees on Des Moines streets each spring and summer. Indianola's historic Carnegie Library would not be renovated to serve as headquarters for our renowned opera company. The Arts Center would not be able to continue free admission, and the Des Moines Symphony would not be able to support a youth academy for young members. There are many, many, many more examples of what our nonprofit community does to make Central Iowa such a great place to live, to work, to play, all while supporting good mental health. At a recent family party to celebrate my retirement, I shared the following challenge with my beloved team grand members, those 18 grand members, grandkids I mentioned earlier. And my wisdom, or my challenge to them, was find your passion, develop that passion, and then give back to that passion. Because as the quotation from Lucado says, no one can do everything, but everyone can do something. Today, we are here together helping to do something to positively impact the mental health needs of our friends, our family members, our neighbors, and our community as a whole. I am really grateful for the hope and healing provided by the Mind and Spirit Counseling Center and the thousands they serve. And I'm also grateful for each of you attending and generously supporting the center through this year's Women Helping Women Luncheon. Thank you so much for this recognition.
Thank you, Connie, for those inspiring remarks. I hope this table over here was paying attention to that. You truly exemplify the meaning of this event, and we appreciate your passion you bring to the table each and every day. It's now my pleasure to introduce and share a few words about today's speaker, Dr. Jan Fried. Everyone should have a friend and colleague like Jan Fried. She is loyal, funny, insightful, empathetic, and smart. I've known her for over 35 years, and I still come away from every conversation with her learning something and always feeling good about it. You have a brief bio of her in your program, but here's a bit more. Yes, she's a PhD professor and an author. She's a friend, she's a spouse, she's a mother, a grandmother, a mentor, a teacher, a volunteer extraordinaire. She covers the waterfront. Bruce Heston, a friend of hers, met Jan at Central College back in 1973. And 50 years later, Bruce reflected on Jan's upbeat, consistently positive, can-do persona that's gone unchanged. And another longtime college friend of Jan's, Beth Christman, described Jan as authentic and a lot of fun. She finds the good in people with her comfortable and thoughtful approach. She believes our better days are ahead, even at my age. Her writing focuses upon aging, saging, and making a difference in your community and in your life, regardless of your age, your abilities, your income, or your background. So I'm excited to bring Jan to the stage to inspire us as we continue to work on our own breadcrumb legacy. Please welcome Jan Fried.
Well, thank you very much, Susan, and that's such a, I felt like walking out in the middle of that introduction. That was beautiful, thank you. And I've always said this is one of my favorite fundraising events because I know so many people. But because I know so many people, that's making me very nervous today. But I'm glad to be here. I wanted to just start with a long story made short about Connie Isaacson, because when I first met her, Well, first of all, before I met her, a handful of us, Carl Voss included, Jan Hill, there were about a handful of us trying to get a skate park down by the river. And we were part of AMIS, which stands for a Mid-Iowa Organizing Strategy. And we'd been trying to get this skate park downtown for about 15 years. I would describe it to people that I was young when we started and middle-aged when we were getting going, okay? And if you remember the movie several years ago, it was nominated for an Oscar, but it was called Boyhood, where they followed the same actors, actresses, for 12 years, made this movie. That's what this skate park felt like. And it wasn't until we got a grant from the Community Foundation that we could get Connie Isaacson involved, and the rest is history. Connie got involved, she got the right people around the table, which we struggled with, and when we got the right people, it became a reality. And Connie used to say that if your city doesn't have a skate park, it becomes one. And so I was a soccer mom. I didn't have any kids that skateboarded, but I was part of this team, and now it's, you know, nationally recognized, and it's really a great contribution. And that's how I first initially got to know Connie. So today I'm going to talk about what if the rest of your life is the best of your life. And I want to start off by saying that I've been a student of the second half of life since my professional mentor, Dr. Elmer Burak. He was at the University of Illinois, Chicago. He died 12 years ago at 82. But he sent me this book, and he said, Jan, read this. Baby boomers are not going to know what to do with the rest of their life. And when I read this, I got it in about 2003. And when I read this, you know, I just wanted to underline every sentence. It really captivated me. And this is the foundational book for the organization that I'm involved in, which is called SAGING International. And it's SAGE-ING. And I've written about saging so much that my computer always comes back and says, you know, you spell check, you mean sagging. And I'm like, no. There's some of that, probably, but no, it's SAGE-ING. And you know, I'm really intrigued with this topic. It's my focus, I love it. I really call it kind of the non-financial aspect of retirement planning, because we talk about money, but really it's everything else people are concerned with if they have the money figured out. So I'm passionate about the second half of life. Well, when is the second half of life? Well, if the average life expectancy for women is 80 and 76 for men, then the second half of life starts about 40. And when I share that in workshops, people are like, whoa, you know, that's sooner than I think. I mean, and it is, it really is. So I want to share some facts about that I received from the Mind and Spirit Counseling Center. The divorce rate for people 50 plus is higher than average. Young adults 18 to 25 are much more likely than people 50 plus to experience depression, though the rates are rising. And we just heard Connie mention this. The suicide rate for people 50 plus is higher than average, particularly for white males, but it's also, I think you said the second, isn't the second leading cause of death for young people. Alcohol abuse is being called a silent epidemic. Each year, 1 in 5 women in the United States has a mental health problem such as depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, or an eating disorder. Studies show that people who feel well-connected and supported have lower rates of anxiety and depression than those who do not have social connections, and those who do not have social connections are at a higher rate for suicide, low self-esteem, and antisocial behaviors. So how do we make the rest of life the best of life? Well, please know that I don't have any answers, and what I'm going to share with you, I don't. But what I'm going to share with you is not easy to do. So it's not easy, and I don't have answers. But in less than 20 minutes, I'm going to share with you what I've learned during the past 20 years, and I've organized my remarks around five areas. Embracing aging. We live in a youth-centric culture. Younger is often promoted as better. Most advertisements are about anti-aging, not embracing aging. Now, I will admit, I too use some anti-aging cream, but I do that because I also use lotion on my leather purses. So if it works on my leather purses, I'm thinking, you know, the lotion on my face might help too. But when we're talking about anti-aging, that really is external work. And when we're talking about saging, we're talking about internal work. Society causes many of us to have FOGO. Now, we've heard of FOMO, but FOGO is fear of getting older. The statistics on young adults that I just shared and Connie shared do not make youth sound like the perfect age. And it's time to push back. Now, it is happening, and some people out there, celebrities, are really trying hard, Jane Fonda being one of them. You know, I loved Grace and Frankie. And the last season was really a lot about saging, because they kind of deal with some of the things I'm going to talk about today. Jane Fonda also was on a cover of a magazine recently that says, life gets better with age. And now she's in a new movie, I think book club, 80 with Brady, or 84 Brady, or I haven't seen it yet. I wanted to. I wrote about it, but I haven't seen it yet. And Martha Stewart at 81 is on the cover of the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue. Now, I have to tell you, I don't think at any age would I have qualified to be on the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue. And I was even a lifeguard. I wore swimsuits a lot, but I don't think I could be on the cover, okay? But in saging talk, we don't ask how old someone is. We ask, how many years of life experience do you have? And the question I ask is, would you trade your life experience to be younger again? Now, there are certain aspects, like I used to be able to do the splits and, you know, I mean, things like that. You know, I was a cheerleader. But, you know, would you really trade your life experience? Now, in 1985, and this is before many of you were probably born, there was an award-winning movie, Oscar-winning movie, in which the residents, it was called Cocoon. And the residents of a Florida retirement home, they stumble across an alien fountain of youth. They discover that if they swim in this swimming pool, oh, they're young, they're energetic. I mean, it really takes them back. And the aliens, I'm trying to condense it because many of you probably haven't seen it, but the aliens offer to take these residents with them on the spaceship. And if they get on the spaceship, they're told they will never die, they'll never get sick, and they'll never grow old. Now, at the time this came out in 1985, some friends and I, we were talking about this, because honestly, it was a very popular movie, and we were talking about, would you get on the spaceship to leave everyone and everything you love behind? And most of us said, no. We want to have life experience. Unlock purpose. Another aspect that I think is important. And Jim kind of mentioned purpose. Regardless of your age, what's your reason for getting up in the morning? We all need to have a reason. And people who seek meaning beyond themselves are healthier, happier, and live longer. Research says 7 years longer. Now, purpose, we often think with a big P, you know, like it's got to be really monumental, something really important. I've got to be Mother Teresa. I've got to be Martin Luther King Jr. or, you know, other notary people that we know of. But really, purpose with a little P, you know, think about how you want to help or contribute. Jim talked about service. Think about who you want to help. Think about what energizes you and what drains you. We unlock purpose by exploring, by experimenting. Some people say, well, you know, I'll discover it. Well, discovery, but you have to do something to discover it. And so that's where the exploring, experimenting, trying new things. And I often say, you know, think about your passions. We heard Connie talk about passion, your gifts, and your values. Last year, there was a popular movie called A Man Called Otto with Tom Hanks. And Otto, he's not just a man who's lost his wife, but he's a man who's lost his purpose. He's bitter, he's angry, difficult. I loved the neighbor, if you saw the movie, I loved the Latina neighbor who was always trying to warm him up, you know? And she eventually got there. Years ago, there was a movie called About Smith, where Warren Smith, played by Jack Nicholson, he's lost his way. His wife dies too. He's retired. He doesn't know what to do with his life. He buys an RV, travels around the country. But again, you know, when we lose our purpose, and so much of our purpose is often tied to our identity, which is often tied to what we do. So if we are what we do, and we don't do it anymore, then who are we? So we need a reason for getting up in the morning. Face mortality. Thinking about death can impact how you live your life. The Benedictines teach us, keep death daily before your eyes. At any moment, we might breathe our last breath, and it can come at any time. Closeness to death makes life better. A few years ago, I did a TEDx talk called Embracing Death, Seeing Life Through a Different Lens, where I explain how I've integrated these concepts into my leadership courses, leadership workshops, and I talk about death a lot. I tend to plan my funeral the way others plan weddings or parties. I like to revise it. I get new ideas. You know, I go to funeral, I collect eulogies, I collect obituaries. I mean, I love it. I often say another movie that I refer to is Harold and Maude. I mean, I'm very much like Maude. Harold and Maude was an old movie, kind of a cult movie now, where a young suicidal man meets this older, he's suicidal and she's passionate about life, and they meet at a funeral because they like to go to funerals. And so I'm a lot like Maude. But I'm also a hospice volunteer, and I've done a lot of grief work. And COVID made death front and center. Not only did we lose people, but we lost companies, industries, jobs. Grief and death is, most of us are experiencing a lot of deep grief and death. And all of these changes involve relationships. I recently learned about a new app. You know, we're all into apps now. And this app is called We Croak. And if you go to the website, okay, the tagline is, we find happiness by contemplating our mortality. And it's inspired by a Bhutanese folk saying, to be a happy person, one must contemplate death 5 times daily. Every day, the app sends you 5 invitations to stop and think about death. Now, think about how you want to be eulogized at your funeral. In other words, think about how you want to be remembered. Then make sure you're living in that way, and the earlier we figure this out, the better, which is why I love to introduce these concepts to like 22-year-olds. And they love it once they kind of understand where I'm coming from and if I connect the dots. Value relationships. Susan, I think, will like this. In 1966, the Beatles asked us 2 questions that continue to haunt us. Ah, look at all the lonely people. Where do they all come from? Ah, look at all the lonely people. Where do they all belong? Loneliness was an epidemic before the pandemic, and it's even worse now. When we're younger, it's easier to form friendships through many organic situations. Most friendships tend to be front-end loaded through experiences on our life journey: daycare, school, sports, college, work, community, faith-based activities. All of these settings are conducive to creating friendships, but they're most common in the earliest phases of our life. I mean, even soccer, you know, John and I were soccer parents for so long, and we thought we'd stay in touch with these soccer parents forever, but it just didn't happen. Research indicates that our circle of friends is shrinking. Even though we have Facebook, all the social media, people are still lonely, and our circle of friends is shrinking for people of all ages. People quit work, they retire, they move away, they die. Some friendships don't last, or others become unhealthy. In Robert Waldinger's TED Talk, What Makes a Good Life? Lessons from the Longest Study on Happiness, and he has a recent book out called The Good Life, Waldinger says that while many young people tend to think that fame, fortune, and hard work will bring them happiness, it's actually our social connections that are most important for our health and well-being. The National Academy of Sciences reported that more than one-third of adults aged 45 and older feel lonely. Dr. Vivek Murthy, the Surgeon General, author of Together, the Healing Power of Human Connections in a Sometimes Lonely World, said recently in a New York Times essay, when people are socially disconnected, their risk of anxiety and depression increases. So does their risk of heart disease, dementia, and stroke. The increased risk of premature death associated with social disconnection is comparable to smoking daily and may be even greater than the risk associated with obesity. We are facing a friendship recession. This is a term being used to describe the rise in the number of people who lack close friends, who have fewer people to turn to in times of crisis. While we don't need lots of friends, we need to have a support group of people we trust. Who would you call in the middle of the night with an emergency? Remember that illness starts with I, and wellness starts with we. We need to continue to make connections because, as my friend Michelle Witte says, connection is protection. Think legacy. Psychoanalyst Eric Erickson wrote that in the middle years of adult life, which we know now is like 40, we come to realize I am what survives me. Actually, Rabbi Harold Kushner, who just passed away, wrote the book When Bad Things Happen to Good People, but he also wrote a book called When All I Ever Have Isn't Enough. And in that book, he talks about there's a point in time when instead of thinking about how much higher can I climb, we start looking back. And that's what we're talking about with I am what survived me. What can I leave behind? Or what can I do now to make future generations better? Legacy is not just for the rich and famous, but for all of us. It's not just at the end of life, because we don't know when the end is. It's for now. Leaving it, and we're leaving our legacy in what I call bite-sized pieces. We're leaving it all the time in breadcrumbs, leaving a trail along the way. That can be negative. It's not guaranteed to be positive unless we're intentional and we think about it. Our breadcrumb legacy can be our true star, our North Star, our guiding light. And legacy, I had someone at a workshop recently say to me, well, don't you think it's self-centered to be thinking about your legacy all the time? And I said, well, substitute the word impact. What kind of impact do you want to have on others? Because you could be having a negative impact if you're not thinking about it. So research indicates that people at the end of life want to know that their life mattered, that mattering matters. What you've learned, your wisdom, is as valuable as what you've earned. So find a way to pass it on. In closing, how do we make the rest of life the best of life? We embrace aging. We unlock purpose. We face mortality. We value relationships. We think legacy. And we look for role models. Who's living a life that looks attractive to you and why? Keep going, keep growing. Stay relevant, stay engaged. And I'll end with a story I read about Gandhi when he was traveling in England. A reporter from India approached him and said, Mahatma, I'm writing an article about you for the people in India. What is your message I can share with them? Gandhi was about to board a train and quickly wrote on a piece of paper then and handed it to the reporter just as the train took off. The reporter opened the piece of paper and it said, my life is my message. So be the example for others to see. May you live the life, may you live your life in the way you want to be remembered so that the rest of your life is the best of your life. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. Thanks for sharing your thoughts with us, especially the reminder that no matter our age, we can think about living our life with purpose and meaning. Thank you for encouraging us to reflect on what our purpose-driven lives look like and how to live them authentically. Hi, everybody. I'm Lori Sloterdijk, Director of... I'm sorry for those people. I'm the director of development at the center. I'm the one who sent you letters, and then I sent an email, then we sent some more letters, then we sent some more emails. Finally, you got your invitation, and here we all are. So thank you for putting up with all of that and for being here with us today. Thanks again, Jan, for agreeing to be our speaker and sharing those words with us. I also want to express my gratitude to Connie. You have done so much to develop this event over the years and done so much for the center itself. Honoring you today on the 25th anniversary was the perfect time to say thank you. On a personal level, Connie has been a friend and mentor to me for almost 40 years. She's helped me discover my purpose many times. Thank you for your guidance and friendship, Connie. It means the world to me. I want to give a shout out to Ann Kelly and Susan Voss for their willingness to be the co-chairs of this year's luncheon event. You've done an incredible job, and I want to thank you for your dedication and leadership. We are fortunate to live in a community. We are fortunate to live in a community that boast an abundance of nonprofits with purposes that strengthen society. We are even luckier that each of you are invested in this community and chooses to support these organizations so willingly. Your care for others is purposeful and meaningful. On behalf of our clients who receive services because of you, thank you. I'm grateful for your trust in our mission, and you bring me hope that we'll continue to make a difference together. Your support of Women Helping Women and the Center is inspiring. The work between clients and therapists is ongoing, with wait lists that continue to grow and a workforce that is limited. Please continue to keep Mind and Spirit Counseling Center and our mission high on your list as you manage your giving decisions. You make it possible for us to provide hope and healing to those who need it but cannot afford it. Before we conclude today's event, I'd like to remind you about a couple of things. Please leave your mark, if you didn't have time to do it on your way in, on the art canvases that are located outside the ballroom doors. We're excited to display these at the center in honor of the 25th anniversary. And thank you, Laura, wherever you are, for sharing your talents with all of us in this way. I want to remind you to take your envelopes home with you that a few volunteers painstakingly stuffed and put together. There's lots of good information in there, and a special postcard from Jan to remind you to make the rest of your life the best of your life, and don't forget your chocolates if you haven't eaten it already. Hope you'll mark your calendars for next year's Women Helping Women event on Friday, May 17th, 2024. That sounds like really a long way away. I'd like to end our time together with a poem from Mary Oliver that you may recognize. I believe her words are a reminder that it is ultimately our job to fill our own lives with meaning. The summer day. Who made the world? Who made the swan
and the black bear? Who made the grasshopper? This grasshopper, I mean. The one who has flung herself out of the grass, the one who is eating sugar out of my hand, who is moving her jaws back and forth instead of up and down, who is gazing around with her enormous and complicated eyes. Now she lifts her pale forearms and thoroughly washes her face. Now she snaps her wings open and floats away. I don't know exactly what a prayer is. I do know how to pay attention, how to fall down into the grass, how to kneel down in the grass, how to be idle and blessed, how to stroll through the fields, which is what I have been doing all day. Tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Thank you for being here today, and enjoy your weekend.